us to speak on the ethical and legal aspects of biobanking. And I would like to share my experience with implementing the Human Biomedical Research Act as a senior consultant to the Ministry of Health in Singapore. I was associated with them in the division of regulatory policy and licensing, but now that the law has been enacted, I'm now with the regulatory compliance and enforcement team. So the Human Biomedical Research Act, or the HBRA for short, is the first piece of legislation we have in Singapore that regulates the conduct of human research. And it comprises a research component, a research framework, which governs the conduct of research on human and human-derived biological material. And there's a tissue framework, which deals with the use of human tissue in research, including the regulation of biobanks. The HBRA was enacted on the 21st of August 2015, that's 4 years ago. And it was intentional that we were activated gradually over 4 years to give all stakeholders a chance to adapt and get ready for it. And the last part of this framework, the last part that is to be activated is the tissue framework, and that will be activated in November this year. Now, we encountered a number of ethical and legal issues during the implementation of the HBRA. And today, I shall first consider the prohibition against trading in human tissues. Now, this may seem like a logical thing to do, but we had a lot of objections from commercial biobanks and researchers who obtained human tissues from such companies. Biobanks were also worried that if they cannot generate revenue from the provision of human tissues, they cannot be financially self-sustainable. And patient donors feel that if biobanks earn money from the tissue they provide, they should have a share of the revenue. So a common question that arose was the definition of human tissues. What about cell lines? What about FFP material? What about DNA, RNA, and xenografts? Are they human tissues too? The second issue that we shall consider is about the regulation of tissue banking. Now, our Act requires a biobank to notify the Ministry of Health before the start of biobanking activities, provide annual declaration of compliance, and report any serious adverse events. Secondly, they have to exercise supervision and control, formulate SOPs and policies, appoint a person in charge who will go to jail if something goes wrong, and have a system of tracking consent. Now, before tissue can be released for research, the biobank has to, or even exported or imported for research, the biobank has to ensure that certain rules and regulations are complied with. So the questions these issues raise are, one, what is human tissue? More than just a liver or a leg, what about FFP material, cell lines, or molecular extracts? Can human tissue be owned? Because if human tissue is not property, then it cannot be traded anyway, and this prohibition against the commercial trading human tissues becomes a moot point. On the other hand, if tissue can be owned, who owns it? Does the patient own it, or is it the surgeon or the hospital? So can tissue or human tissue be owned and traded? Now, Singapore is a common law jurisdiction like Australia, the UK, and to some extent the United States of America. It has been long established that in common law there is no property in a dead body or parts thereof. So in the early days, there were so-called body snatchers. Now, these were people who stole human remains 1800s. Now, Sharp stole his late mother's body from the cemetery, but he was charged not for the theft of the body, but for the illegal trespass of the cemetery, once again, because there is no property in a dead body. And yet again, there is the civil case of Williams versus Williams in 1882. In this case, the old Mr. Williams left word that in his will that after his death, his body should be cremated. Unfortunately, for reasons not quite clear, the executors of his will buried him instead. His daughter, Miss Williams, then exhumed his body, cremated it according to his wishes, and then sought to claim the expenses from the executors of the will. The court, however, ruled that old Mr. Williams could not decide what is to be done with his dead body. He can only effectively dispose of property in his will, and since there is no property in a dead body, he could not decide what to do with his own dead body after his death. So, from the laws concerning the body of the dead, we now move to that of the living. John Moore, he was treated at the University of California Medical Center for hairy cell leukemia, and as part of his treatment, he consented to splenectomy and allowed the hospital to dispose of any severed tissue or member by cremation. However, instead of cremating his excised spleen, his doctor decided to create a cell line. And it was a very valuable cell line, valued at $3 billion, and patented it. John Moore sued his doctor and the University of California for a share of the revenue. The court ruled, however, that John Moore had no property rights with regard to the excised cells or to any profits resulting from them. However, the court said that we do not purport to hold that excised cells can never be property for any purposes whatsoever. So when can human tissue ever become property? This was not addressed in this particular court hearing, which recognizes the principle that there is no property in a body or parts thereof. So to answer this question as to when can human tissue become property, we need to consider the Australian case of Dootwood versus Spence. Now, Mr. Dootwood was a colorful character acquired the mummified corpse of a two-headed baby and earned money by putting it on exhibition. Now, these were the days when the freak shows were rather popular and people would pay money to see these sort of curiosities, as we may say. The inspector of police, however, Mr. Spence, confiscated the body on the grounds that it was obscene or indecent. Woodward then sued the police inspector to have his property back. The inspector's defense was that since there is no property in a dead body, Woodward did not have a right to possession in the first place, and since he has no right of possession, he could not sue for the return of his property. However, the Australian High Court ruled that because the corpse was mummified and therefore had been subjected to exercise of work or skill, it has acquired property rights. So this case established an exception to the rule of is, we ask the question if the material is normally excreted in the body, such as urine or feces. If it is, it is again not human tissue. If it's not, then we ask the question whether this material has been substantially manipulated. By substantial manipulation, it is not just processes such as cutting, centrifuging, filtering, or freezing. If it has been substantially manipulated, like fixation in formalin or becomes an FFP material, we ask the next question, whether the material is individually identifiable. However, if it has been de-identified, it is not human tissue as well. So the first schedule of our HPRA excludes from the definition of human tissue, human biological material that has been de-identified and has been processed in such a manner that its functional, structural, and biological characteristics are substantially manipulated. To remove any doubts, we clearly state that the following processes, such as dissection, filtering, and freezing, are not considered to be substantial manipulation. So the first implication of our act concerns tissue banking. So under the definition of who is a tissue banker, and there are lots of people who may be tissue banker, including tissue vendors who only collect and store tissue, they are also tissue bankers, because as long as they participate in any of the activities of tissue banking, they are a tissue banker. However, in view of what we have just discussed, for pathology departments, pathology laboratories that store diagnostic FFP blocks but use them for research, they are not biobanks, provided the material supplied is de-identified and so is not considered human tissues. The second implication relates to the prohibition against commercial trading in human tissues. Substantially manipulated material like cell lines, FFP material, molecular extracts, DNA, RNA, and xenografts, they are not human tissue if they have been de-identified and so fall out of the scope of our HPRA. We exempt the prohibition against commercial trading substantially substantially manipulated human biological material such as cell lines, FFP material, and molecular extracts such as DNA, RNA, xenograft, tissue spheroids, organoids. And the reason for this prohibition against commercial trading is really to protect persons from exploitation by companies who may harvest tissues for profit. But apart from the fear of exploitation, contributors of bioresources may not benefit from the expensive drugs and vaccines that are subsequently developed from them. We may remember that in 2007, during the H5N1 outbreak in Indonesia, Indonesia decided to suspend sharing of its viruses with the WHO Global Surveillance Unit, because pharma was able to access those samples from the WHO Global Surveillance Unit and make drugs and vaccines from them. But the rich countries locked up supplies of Tamiflu and expensive vaccines, which were not available to the Indonesians who contributed the material. So the fear of losing control on genetic resources has raised barriers to international research collaboration. Now, the Nagoyan Protocol seeks to address these concerns and aims to ensure fair and equitable sharing of benefits, but unfortunately, it does not apply to human genetic resources. And secondly, not all countries are parties or the signatories. In particular, my own country, Singapore, and the United States of America have not signed the Nagoya Protocol. That said, as I mentioned at the ISBA meeting in Shanghai, we have established a collaboration with a German commercial biobank called Individuman. And this is a very different model of biobanking, in which we established a joint research provide clinical data, we extract clinical data, pathological data, whole genome sequencing data, transcriptomics, phosphoproteomics, proteomics, multiplex immunophenotyping, etc. The data that we generate is then used to populate a global cancer database. And IndivaMed sells the data, the de-identified data, to pharma. In doing so, IndivaMed funds our biobanking activity and infrastructure. They obtain the data to generate revenue. The hospitals have free access to the omics data generated from their samples. So this is a model we have adopted to ensure financial sustainability on the one hand, and on the other, ensure a measure of fair and equitable sharing of benefits. The next topic I will quickly discuss is about return of incidental findings. In the course of research, we may generate incidental findings that are not relevant to research, but have potential clinical significance. Now, this can be a wrong diagnosis. For example, the specimen you receive is said to be colorectal carcinoma, but when you look under the microscope, it's Crohn's disease. It can show undiagnosed disease. So for example, the blood specimen you obtain from supposedly a healthy volunteer, but it shows hyperglycemia. Do you tell the patient that patient could have diabetes? Or it may show potential hereditary genetic disorders when you perform whole genome sequencing on a patient with prostate cancer, but to your surprise, you found a BRCA1 mutation which has implications on the patient's family, the patient's daughters, for example. We may need to remember that research labs are not accredited for clinical service, and research assays may not be subjected to the rigorous validation as expected in a CLIA lab or CAP-accredited lab. Secondly, researchers do not understand the clinical context, and perhaps it should be the clinicians who should communicate the results to the patients. You know, we used to have patients who commit suicide the moment they hear that they have HIV. So there are risks involved with just simply returning research incidental results to the patients. And what if the researcher's result was wrong? And on the other hand, if we make return of incidental findings mandatory, do researchers have a duty to identify and report significant findings? We must also remember that patients have a right not to know, especially when it's a disease over which little can be done. If researchers do not report incidental findings, would the biobanks be liable, since the consent is taken by the biobank and the patient had informed the biobank that they want incidental findings to be returned? Yet once the biobank has released the tissue to the researcher, how is the biobank going to know if the researcher has found incidental findings? So what if the patient has passed on and the incidental finding is a hereditary genetic illness? Is the biobank or the researcher obliged to inform the relatives of the patient donor? So this presents a research dilemma. And for the researcher and biobank to discharge its duty, it is not just costly, but it's also very resource demanding. The Bioethics Advisory Committee in Singapore recommends that the patient donor should be allowed to decide whether he wants to be informed of incidental findings before the research commences. But how can patients realistically decide whether they want the incidental findings returned when they don't know merely to have a discussion with the patient donor if he wants incidental findings to be returned. The biobank or researcher can simply say that their research protocol will not return incidental findings, and if the patient does not agree, he will not be recruited into that study. On the other hand, if the biobank allows the return of incidental findings, that may be quite difficult to do so as well. It is difficult to decide what are clinically significant and actionable findings and what is not actionable. And indeed, what is not actionable now may become actionable 10 years later. So does the biobanker or the researcher have a duty to return incidental findings when it later becomes actionable, and as long as they continue to hold on to that data? Now, the converse is also true. The patient decided that he does not want to receive incidental findings, but the researcher uncovered a clinically very significant and easily actionable finding. The patient has said he doesn't want to know, but if the researcher is a doctor, he may be bound by medical ethics, by his professional ethics, to return that very significant and actionable clinical finding. So this, let's look at this approach in the USA regarding this. Indeed, in the United States, federal regulations are also silent about the return of incidental findings, and they neither require nor disallow the return of incidental findings. On the other hand, in keeping with a doctor's professional ethics, the FDA states that the investigator should inform a subject when medical care is needed. So the US Office of Human Research Protection recommends this 2x2 table to help determine if an incidental finding should be returned, depending on whether the results have been validated and whether they are clinically actionable. So if a research incidental finding is both actionable and validated, then it's probably indicated. If it's not actionable and not validated, then it's probably not indicated. However, if this incidental finding is actionable but not validated, or vice versa, then it's only possibly indicated. It may help, but not very much. So in summary, the law deals with rights and liability. The law must not be ambiguous and needs to be strictly applied. In contrast, ethics deals with right and wrong, and there are always different ethical schools of thought. You might say